Fusion in DaVinci Resolve uses media nodes to communicate between the edit and the color page, so media in, media out. However, there's also a concept of loader and saver nodes, and these can be incredibly helpful to store temporary render results as well as to work with some custom, more advanced workflows. So I want to discuss what these use case scenarios are for these nodes and show you how you can use them in DaVinci Resolve. So let's have a look. By default, if I go from any clip to the Fusion page, I get by default my media in and my media out nodes. And if I do any work in Fusion, I do it in between, and whatever comes from the edit goes into Fusion, whatever goes to media out goes to the color page and for final delivery, right? So, but you see here under the I/O tools, there's still a loader and a saver node. And if I click any one of them, saver node, loader node, you see I get also a file pop-up, and these nodes directly access the disk. So they don't have anything to do with Resolve's overall media management. They don't access the media library, etc. They go to a direct file path on disk. Now, why would I want this? First of all, I could use this for temporary caching or for temporary renderers. Especially if I do very complex work, very complex composites, which are time consuming to compute, I can render to disk at any point in the flow. And then later, when I continue working, I can just load this again and basically forget the rest, disable the rest, disconnect the rest, and I just go back on the file system and work with my temporary result and continue working with this. Another option could be that I create some assets in Fusion which I am reusing in other projects and in other areas. So this way I can render it to disk at one place, and then wherever else on a different project, on a different, even completely independent of even Resolve's database, wherever I continue working with this, I can load it again with a loader node directly pointing to that file path. A third scenario can be integration with other software, especially with 3D software. So if I'm collaborating with a 3D artist, or if I work myself with Blender or Maya or other 3D applications, then these applications typically render out image file sequences with lots of images in EXR files or JPEG files, so they're different formats. They work less often with the typical video formats like ProRes and MP4 formats and so on. And those file sequences I can also directly access here, so I don't need to go via the media pool for these, let's say, auxiliary stuff that I'm getting from this collaboration. I can keep it out of my main video project, so to speak. So I can use this to access this very efficiently. Okay, let's have a look at an example how this works. And to illustrate, I am opening here a bigger comp from a previous 3D logo experiment tutorial that I did before. So this does render a while. Actually, there are two renderers. One of them renders the model here, the logo in 3D, and the other one actually does a particle renderer. And then I'm using these for additional stuff afterwards. Now let's say I want to save my results from the 3D renderer, kind of lock them, put them to disk, and then later continue using them in 2D and maybe try different effects with them, perhaps even use the particles somewhere else for another project or so. Then I can add here the saver node, and saver here, I get it from the control spacebar menu in this case. I can add it just like this. And file name, browse, I'm putting it here somewhere. Okay, renderer. I'll just name it logo.exr. I can save it on the disk. Now here I am restricted. I can only save EXR files, at least at the moment. Fusion Studio used this as the primary mode of rendering stuff. So you could select anything here, including QuickTime container files and so on. So here I'm restricted, but EXR is the most useful and most capable compositing format. So there are some very specific properties to EXR, and I'll just mention a few of them, which make it a suitable format. It was invented for compositing and for work with 3D applications, and that's maybe the reason why it is used as the default and as the preference here by Resolve. So EXR files give you a file sequence. They can do a few things, like they can output multiple channels. So this is popular in 3D applications. My renderer here, my 3D renderer, is also giving me a Z channel and a normal channel, and the EXR file can save all of those. So it can save here the Z and the normal. You can just leave them all ticked unless you want to exclude a channel. So if a channel doesn't exist, it won't come, even if the checkbox is here. But if you say, oh no, I don't need that Z channel, but I have it before, if it's coming and I don't need it, I can disable it. So these are like the 3D specific channels which can be exported with EXR. So that's one advantage, or one specific point of EXR. And another one is that EXR can work with really high quality compressions, or even uncompressed. So if I look here at the compression, first of all, here I have the bit depth, which I can choose between 16 and float 32. Let's use 16, usually that's enough. But this is already more than the normal video formats, and that's because EXR files can work if you are working with linear, in linear space. So if your log footage or your RGB footage, if you convert that into linear space, which in professional pipelines happens, then you can use EXR to directly save it without any additional conversion. And then if I look at the compression formats, the first few until this PITS wavelet compression, all these are lossless compressions. So there is no losses whatsoever. So all the video formats like ProRes, including ProRes RAW or Blackmagic RAW, these are very, very high quality formats in some cases, like the RAW formats, but they are still lossy. So they're not 100% lossless. These are bit by bit exactly lossless formats. And then down here, there are a few options which are lossy. The last one here, DWA DreamWorks Animation Codec, is this. This is a lossy format. It's similar to JPEG, but with a very, very high quality. So this is about the highest quality that you can get, that you have here. And the reason why we have this here is that this is intended for pipelines where you do not want to lose any data, either because you're doing a temporary render and then import it again, and you can work with big file sequences for maybe a short project, for a short timeline, for a short segment, where you do that, you probably are okay to save this for your 100 frames you're working on, but due to your temporary step, you're not including any form of error. The same if you do any round trips to other software, if you work with 3D artists, if you work with other applications, if you do compositing externally with a different software, you could use this format. So that's really what it's intended for. So here I'll just use the zip compression, which is pretty good for like 3D renderers. The wavelet one may be a bit better with live action footage. So I just use this one. And let me just put a second one here, and I'll just quickly copy this and put one here for my particles. And I quickly rename this instead of logo particles. And here you see I have my file path in here. Now let me render this. And to render this, first of all, I will just quickly reduce my render range to just a few frames, just to demonstrate. Control mouse drag, you can reduce your render range. This is for the preview, so if I play here, it will only play between the render range, but also for the render range for the saver nodes, and I can trigger them by clicking here on Fusion Render All Savers, and these two branches, these two savers, will now be rendered. Render complete, let me load them again. So I'll just add the loader, control spacebar, loader, and select here. So first the logo sequence, and you can just, if you have image sequences, you can just select one and it will automatically recognize the sequence. So it's automatically bringing in here multiple frames, five frames in this case. And these sequences also have a significant advantage for complex rendering, because if your renderer fails or crashes or you stop it in between, then whatever you rendered until this point, you still have as usable files on the disk. Whereas these MP4 files or so, if your renderer crashes or if you stop it, then the whole file is not usable. Let me connect this here. And now I bring, so this was the one loader, and the second loader, let me bring it in for the particles. And now I have to pay attention. I only rendered five frames here. However, those five frames, so by default they are from 0 to 5. So I should just undo the render range and maybe look from 0 to frame 5 if I now look at these. So these are 6 frames actually. So these 6 frames I can load now. Logo on the left, particles on the right. And if you look at the logo, I am getting my passes. So if I look here at the different channels, you see there's a Z channel, there are normal channels. So this is directly coming from the EXR file. And now if I want, I can continue using this downwards for my 2D comp and comp my particles again together, even do my ambient occlusion and other stuff. And now for these frames here, if you see which nodes light up, you see that that was maybe a bit too fast to see. Let me purge this and render it once again. Just check which nodes light up for computational requirement. You see only these, and here nothing is happening because this part is disconnected and not being used for the work that I'm doing now from the loader onwards. Okay, so here I have separated my flow with the saver nodes and then the loader nodes to continue the work. If you work with 3D applications, you might use only the loader node to import external EXR files. Here you might be wondering, if I do the separation, why don't I just cache to disk? Yes, I can do that as well. So if you just have a complex renderer or something, you can do a right click and do cache to disk, and that does something pretty similar to what I have just done here. It just gives you a bit less control. So with the loader and saver nodes, I can decide on compression formats and on quality and on channels that I'm saving and so on. So I have a bit more control, and I can, as I mentioned before, I can decide to render something and then maybe even use it in a different comp, in a different environment. Okay, so this was my short overview for the loader and saver nodes. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments. Also about EXR file formats or file formats for compositing in general. I recently did a longer video about this in my training course, in my compositing training course, which you can find on my website. If you want more in this direction on YouTube, let me know. I can also do some more free stuff in this direction. Just let me know in the comments. Otherwise, like and subscribe. My name is Bernd. Thanks for watching. See you next time.